talking a long time.
There's several messages quite a few months ago before we ever came out here about our perspectives. Y'all remember that? To trade in our perspectives for God's perspective. And that's what pastor's coming back on. Man, the things, Christ dying for us, all that, the shedding of the blood, everything is for our good. That's ministered to me so much. That's blessed me so much. And this is going to be just kind of along the same thing, just in a different area, not about the shedding of blood or the gold. It's in another area. But things have been being built on. And it's what she's been saying, line up on the line and precept upon precept. Not chopping through the onion, but peeling it back a layer at a time. It's being revealed a layer at a time to us. And I know it's coming through because about two Wednesday nights ago on a Zoom meeting, after the Bible study, there was about five people that spoke afterwards. Three of them spoke along the same thread. It was Carla Bauer, Chris Jones, and Brother Art. They all said the same thing. My perspective is changing. They said it in a different way, but every one of them, I just sat back and listened. They talked about, I'm seeing this in a different way, and it's about what the lesson was on that night and what's been going on for the past month, 5 weeks, something like that. My perspective is changing. Man, God was plowing that ground months ago for the seed that's being planted now, line upon line and precept upon precept. Today, I want to talk about how we view God in the area of your money, our finances. Okay? Right then, you've probably already had a twinge in your stomach whenever you saw a pastor sitting down and me coming up here. That's the first twinge. The second twinge, talking about money in church. Well, you've come in, some questions might have come in your mind. I see these fans. I wonder if they're needing some money for these fans. I wonder if the pastor's wanting a raise. She didn't want to address the people, so she's going to get Max to do it. He's done. He'll do anything. What about, it's been COVID. What about this COVID stuff? Finances of the church might be hurting, so we're probably going to preach about money. I just want to put it to rest. It's none of the above. It's not even close. It's about our perspective of God and how we view Him. But if we were really being honest, and I would be one of them, and somebody starts talking about money, the first question that comes up in my mind is that three-letter word, why? Why are they talking about money? Is there a reason? John 10:10 tells us that the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And I believe that enemies come in and stolen the blessings that God has for us in the area of our finances. God desires to bless us. It's for our good. It's for our good. The things through the finances, people talking about finances in church has been so distorted and abused by preachers all along the way, the televangelists. Just the other night, the fire department, I was up late and I was flipping the channels. Less than a minute, three different channels are all saying, give me $1,000 for this, that, and you'll get this. I want to spend just a second saying what this is not about this morning. It's not about giving to get something. Please hear my heart. It's not that. It's not giving. I'm not telling you to give something so I can get that. It's not that at all. And we're talking about, the title of it is the principle of first. And I'm not talking about the feast of first fruits. I'm not talking about the offering of first fruits. It's all involved. But I'm talking about just a principle of first. And lastly, I'm not talking about a mathematical principle. I'm 56 years old. I've been raised in church all my life. Whenever I was raised up and coming in, it was about 10%. And I do believe in 10%. Don't get me wrong there. But what the deal is, I made the principle of first. I never got it until about 6 or 7 years ago. And I've been in this all my life. And when I got this principle, Suzanne and myself, it changed our lives dramatically. And that's what I want to relate to you. It's our view of God. It changed us so much. Because you see, I had it about a principle of 10%. 10% is always 10%. If I make $1,000 and I believe I need to give $100, that's 10%. It doesn't matter if I give it in January, February, or December. It doesn't matter. 10% is always 10%. That's not what God asks us. It's the principle of first, and that's what we want to talk about today. I made it a mathematical principle. See, I would kind of wait till the end of the year. We'd give every Sunday, just so I could ease my conscience and give. Okay, I threw something in there. Might not have been 10%. And at the end of the year, I'd figure out how much we gave and how much we made. And I'd make up a check and give it to it to make it fit 10%. So I'm good. I've met your requirement, I'm good. But when I wrote that check, it says something in there. We're going to talk about being a cheerful giver. I was not a cheerful giver. And I'm thinking, what I could do with this money? Man, if everybody else, and I'm just being honest. Leah, you said you're being transparent. I'm being transparent. I wrote that check. A lot of my buddies got a little bit better hunting lease, a little bit better four-wheeler, better guns. I'm sitting there going, man, I could have all that stuff, 10%, if I kept this check. But that's what I'm supposed to do. I'm going to give it because that's what I was raised to do. Under compulsion, under feeling compelled. This is not about any of that. When we finally found, we were taught, and we were in transitions of churches, we'd resigned, we were moving up here to Frostburg, we resigned everything in Saginaw, and this comes off in the Blessed Life and over at Gateway, and we was going there, and man, it changed our lives, and I promise you, I wasn't doing this, well, maybe my finances will get better if I do that. I just realized I've been doing it wrong. It's all in my head. It was all a head thing. When we get it out of our head and into our heart, it's all about our heart. It's all about knowing that it's for our good with that comforting fact. And it's not about giving. It's not about getting to give. It's not giving to give. It's getting to give. And that's what we want to talk about, the principle of first. I'm going to go through this pretty fast. It's cold. And if you want to, let's stand one more time and let's pray. Lord, I come to you today. Lord, I'm so thankful for your mercy and for your grace. I'm thankful for your principles, Lord. I'm thankful for the example I've had and that it finally got through my head. Lord, please let the people hear what you have for them to hear. Not what I have to say, but what you have to say through me, Lord. Please anoint their ears to hear. And Lord, I need your anointing. I need your help to deliver this right, because it's such a truth. You desire to bless. Lord, please let that flow through today. Let us get us in our hearts. Lord, we give you the praise. In just name I pray. Amen. All right. As usual, we're going to have 3 points. Just tell you where we're headed. The first one is, it's very simple. God owns it all. The second is that he requests the first. The last one is that God desires to bless his children. Let's go to the first one. The first point is that God owns it all. We all know that. But let's just talk about it for just a second. Psalm 24, and I'll tell you, it says, the earth is the Lord and everything in it, the world and all its people belong to him. The one I really love is Psalm 50 and verse 10. It says, for all the animals of the forest are mine, and I own the cattle on 1,000 hills. I know every bird on the mountains, and all the animals of the field are mine. If I was hungry, I wouldn't tell you, for all the world is mine and everything in it. It leaves nothing to exception. Everything is the Lord's. Everything is the Lord's. He owns it all. Wednesday, you were talking about a plumb line in the Bible study. It's saying that we need to know the word because it's our plumb line. It keeps us in center. We're not off to the right, not too far to the left, but it keeps us in the middle. And when we read the Bible and it's revealed to us, we get to see the mistakes that others have made and we can learn from them. It's for a reason. It keeps us in the middle. And that's what we need. It's our plumb line. So with that being said, let's go back to when God said, it is good. Let's go back to Genesis chapter 2. God created man. He created the world, the garden, and everything. He looked back and he said, it is good. Because everything was in the order that God had placed it in at that time. It was good. God saw that it was good. Chapter 2, verse 15. The Lord God placed the man in the garden of Eden to tend, and watch over it. I wish this was up behind us because it's highlighted. To tend. But the Lord God warned him, you may freely eat the fruit of every tree in the garden except the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. If you eat of its fruit, you're sure to die. God put rules. When it was good, God is the owner and man was the steward. That's the order that we're supposed to have. We recognize that everything is God's. Everything is God's. Adam ran into problems and Eve. When they took on the role of ownership, they stepped out of stewardship and into ownership. God had something set apart. He gave them out, and they were in there to tend the garden. Everything belonged to God except this area right here. But when they thought, well, I'm going to take part of that too. I'm going to assume the role of owner. They lost the blessing. The blessing they were taking out of it. when things were good, he was acknowledging everything's God. That's God's. Something was set apart for God's. And that principle is all through history, all through now, and all until the end. That God is the owner and we're stewards. God has something that's set apart that's His. Today He has something that's set apart that's His. And we miss out on blessings whenever we assume the role of owner and not the role of a steward. He owns it all. Point number two. God requests the first. Whenever I was looking at this and she's talking about, not speak on this, but as a deal, might be putting a deal together for new members, and it's about our what this church believes in giving, what she believes in giving, and what we want to convey to maybe new people that are coming in. So I put some things together because I didn't want to misrepresent one bit. We're human, we can disagree on stuff. I did not want to misrepresent, and I don't want to misspeak today, because this isn't my place. This is the pastor's place. This is Gary and Pam's place. I would never want to do anything. So I want to run it by her. I want to make sure we're on the same page out of respect for her. And whenever I did that, I gave her the outline that I had, and everything was good except one place scratched out. And she was very right, because I'm more of a legalistic person. I got to watch my ways. That's one of my faults, is legalistic. I had God requires the first. I thought, you know, He does. If we're going to be blessed, He requires the first. He requests it. See, He wiped out requires and put requests. He requests the first. I'm going to read a verse. It's talking about first fruit offerings, but the principle runs through it. Proverbs 3, verses 9 and 10. Honor the Lord with your wealth and with the first fruits of all your produce. Then your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will be bursting with wine. That's the principle. Give Him the first, He'll bless the rest. That's this whole thing. Give Him the first, He'll bless the rest. Something is His. That part in the garden was set apart for Him. He has something in our lives, and it's the first. It's the first of everything. The first of our increase is what we're talking about. Well, why is that so special to God? Because if we give Him the first, it takes faith that He's going to bless the rest. But what I was doing I wasn't working 50 years, for 40 years, 35 years, I was making it up at the end of the year. There was absolutely zero faith. It didn't take anything. I knew where I was at. I just make it up, okay, 10%, because I was under a mathematical principle and not a first principle. When you make it the first, you're saying, God, I'm giving this to You, the first thing out of my increase, and I'm trusting that You're going to bless the rest. And I was talking with Leonard yesterday. He was talking about some things. And one of the things, don't get hung up on just the 10%. When you really get this out of your head, I had it in my head about 10%. It was a mathematical deal. When it gets to your heart, all of a sudden you look back, that 10%, that's kind of where we started at. That's way past. That's way past. Don't get hung up on the 10%. Do something. I just encourage you to do something. Don't, if you're saying, I can't give the 10%, God says in Malachi, trust me, try me in this. Try me, and I'll take care of it. I'll open up the windows of heaven. But give Him something at the first. Just that effort, that's what He'll bless. The first belongs to Him. And it shows this story of first all through the Bible. If you go back to Joshua 6, when the children of Israel were coming out of the desert and they're going into the promised land, they had the same clothes, 40 years. They had the same clothes. But they came to the first city. And God said, He gave specific instructions. Joshua 6, verse 17. It says, Jericho and everything in it must be completely destroyed as an offering to the Lord. If I've had the same clothes for 40 years, and I come up here, we wipe these people out, we got all their closets full of stuff, I might want to get a new pair of clothes on. You know, those sandals might be a little bit worn. I want to get that. He says destroy everything. Everything. Except verse 19. It says everything made from silver, gold, brass, or iron, bring to the treasury of the Lord, for it's sacred. I just want to throw something in there. Is there any blood involved in those metals? There's no blood involved. We're going to talk about that in just a second. Just remember that there's no blood involved in those metals. But they were the first. It's bringing in, it wasn't sacred. God doesn't need the gold, the silver, the brass, or the iron. He didn't need any of it, but it was the first. Bring me the first. I'll bless the rest. It took faith. They'd been wandering around forever. They were ready for some different things. They'd had quail and manna. That's pretty good, but 40 years of it? I'd like to have that cow over there we just had to burn and give away. I'd like to have that leaf, that lamb. I'd like to have that pork. He said, burn it all. Give me the first, and I'll give you so much more. That was his promise. That was his promise then. It's his promise today. It's the principles of God. It's the principle of first. You know, and you might be thinking, and even me, in my mind, I think, well, you know, that was after the law. That was after Moses. That was that, you know, in Christ is coming, the law's done away with. Okay. Let's go back to Genesis chapter 4, before the law. This is out of the Message. I like the way it reads. Genesis 4, verses 3 and 4. It says, time passed. Cain brought an offering to God from the produce of his farm. Abel also brought an offering, but from the firstborn animals of his herd, choice cuts of meat. He gave him the best. He gave him the first. I think it might have been King James. It says, in the process of time, Cain brought an offering to the Lord, some of his produce. But Abel brought the first of his lambs. He brought him the first. It's about the first. It's not about... Forever, I thought that right there was about the blood. And I didn't understand it. Because I thought, okay, well, he gave an animal, so that has to do with the blood sacrifice. He gave something of the produce. That's not what it's about. It's about, it was because of the first. That metal back there, there was no blood involved that was brought to this treasury. But it was the first. These animals that Abel sacrificed, they were the first. You give him the first, he'll bless the rest. The New Testament also talks about it. Whenever they're asking him, do we need to pay taxes? He said, whose picture's on the coin? They said, Caesar's. He said, give to Caesar's what is Caesar's, but give unto God what is God's. God requests something. God does have ownership. It's through there. It's from the beginning all the way through. He asked for the first. You know, when we give him the first, I said it takes faith. In Hebrews, it says that without faith, it's impossible to please God. This is just another leg of that. Give him the first, and he'll bless the rest, okay? He'll also multiply it. Whenever we do that, he'll also multiply it. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 through 12. I'm going to talk about this for just a second, see where we are. You're going to be running close. Anyway, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, it says, remember this. This is all the NLT. A farmer who plants only a few seeds will get a small crop, but the one who plants generously will get a generous crop. You must each decide in your heart how much to give, and don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure, for God loves a cheerful giver. Remember what I said when I was under that deal of 10%? I gave it at the end of the year. I gave it reluctantly. I didn't want to give that money. I wanted it for me. I was thinking, how many more toys that we could have? How much better house we could have? I'm thinking all these things. And I gave it reluctantly and under pressure because I felt like I had to. Because if I don't do that, God, I'm going to be under a curse. If I don't do that, I can't have it. That's not what this is. It's about giving the first, he'll bless the rest. And he does it. He's changed mine and Suzanne so much. He's changed our lives so much in the last 6 or 7 years. I can't begin. There's not enough time to even go into. But he's done so much for us. Let's go on. It says he loves a cheerful giver. And God will generously provide all your need. Then you will always have everything you need and plenty left over to share with others. That's the biggest thing that's changed in our lives. Plenty left over to share with others. As the scriptures say, they share freely and give generously to the poor. Their good deeds will be remembered forever. For God is the one who provides seed for the farmer and then bread to eat. In the same way, he will provide and increase your resources and then produce a great harvest of generosity in you. He's given us this promise right here. Not only am I going to take care of you, I'm going to take care of you when you obey me in this. A generous spirit's going to come up in you, and you're going to want to give to others. And I can testify to that. That's 100% true. I could not have said that 6 or 7 years ago. I had not one generous bone in my body, probably. Things change when you follow the principles of God. It says, yes, you will be enriched in every way. so that you can always be generous. And when we take your gifts to those who need them, they will thank God. See, this is twofold. And it says this. It says, so two good things will result from this ministry of giving. The needs of the believers will be met, and they will joyfully express their thanks to God. It's not only for us, it's for everybody else. It's so that you'll be blessed, so that we'll all be blessed, but it's also that so we can bless others. You know, we're supposed to be a river. And whenever the blessings come, a lot of times it'd be easy to put up a dam, make a reservoir, and just bring it on, bring it on. But he wants us to be rivers. He wants us to flow through us and touch other lives. He wants us to touch others. That's what the whole thing is. And one time whenever we started changing this around, and I don't have time to go into it, but Suzanne got a good bonus check when she should not have gotten one. She went from full-time to part-time. She got a check here, and we thought, well, the bonuses will be gone. You know, so no big deal. You know, we were good. During that time, we felt like we were supposed to give an offering to the church we were going to. We felt like we were supposed to give that. The bonus ended up being, she still got a bonus. That is a miracle in itself. Not only that, the amount that we felt like God told us to give, her bonus was 10 times that amount. And I don't keep up with a tit for tat on this thing. I do not keep up with it. But it's amazing the things that happened right when we did it, and you can see the pattern. I don't know where we are on it. I have no idea. I just know he blesses. And now we're just, whenever God speaks for us to give, we just want to be obedient and give. You know, and we might mess it up sometimes. I try to be sensitive to God. Suzanne tries to be sensitive to God. When he tells us to help somewhere or do whatever, we want to be sensitive to God, because even like Leonard, who was talking yesterday, it can be harmful. You try to do something where it's not our place to do it. You know, we might be able to do something. And me and Suzanne are not wealthy, good, well off. We're just in a position where we can give where we never were before. And it's a position of our heart that we've never been before, where we want to help somebody. We want to bless. He's blessed so much for us. He's done so much for us. Anyway, we might mess up. It's time to laugh. This has been a lot of heavy stuff. I've talked fast. Well, we were coming back from Tennessee. Our son had a ball game. He played ball in college. Was coming back from it. And we pulled over to get a hamburger. Go in this hamburger joint. It's about middle of the afternoon, so no other cars are in this place. We go in there to get a hamburger. Just me and her. We're sitting there eating. And I'm not paying attention, but an older couple come in. They come in there, and she's noticing. She's a people watcher. She pays attention. Well, they got just the free waters, the little cups. Got the free waters. She brings, they get them. They got a small kid's meal. They cut the hamburger in half, split the french fries. And she said, well, reckon, you know, they need something. I said, I don't know. I wasn't paying attention. I said, do you feel like you need to give? And she goes, I really do. I said, well, just do whatever you need to do. I don't even know. And I asked her this morning, because I didn't want to make her mad and me have to go home with her for telling this. So, because I've done it too. I've messed it up. The story's longer and not as funny as this one, but I've messed up plenty of times. Anyway, she goes by and she put $20 on the table and just kept going. Just, you know, that they could get a little bit more food. We go outside. There was only one car when we went in. That's ours. Now there's two cars. The other one is a nearly brand new Mercedes. I told her, I said, Suzanne, whose car do you think that belongs to? I said, you go back in there and get your money right now. She didn't go back in and get her money. We got in the pickup and we started laughing about it. I said, good grief. I said, God's probably up there. I said, you didn't hear God. And she's just sitting there shaking her head. I said, he's probably up there right now saying, idiots. And I didn't tell you to do that. I bet really he sees the heart, even if we mess up. We were trying to do what he wanted. If my kid messes up, I'm going to want to, it's going to thrill me. Even though it's not something I asked him to do, he did it and messed it up, we still mess it up. Last thing on that story, though, we're going off laughing about it. I said, I bet they're sitting in there right now. He said, you know what? We get more money from people when we split a meal like this. This is how I was able to buy that car out there. I'm hard-headed. I said, I had this. My dad lived this example in front of me. But more than that, there was a young couple we ran around with for a while, and they were not that much older than us. And I saw how they were blessed and everything they did, and how his job just went from boom, boom, boom. I mean, it's just amazing what happened. And I was too stupid to figure out what was going on. They would travel a lot. His job had him travel. And he would give me and Suzanne his tithe check for the next week if he knew he was going to be gone. because it was the first. And he had sent, it was 2 weeks. He had post-date the check, and I would put it in that offering so that the check would be good later on. I couldn't see. And I even told him, I said, Kevin, it doesn't matter. I said, just catch up when you get back. He goes, we just don't do it like that. We just don't do it like that. He understood the principles of God. A lot of times when I talk, and she lets me talk up here a little bit, and I get to bore you for a minute, I talk about Psalm 19, but it's my favorite place in the Bible. There's so much to it. It's the whole story. But back in it, it says that the precepts or the principles of God, they're righteous and they're altogether reliable. And then it says, they're better than gold, than an abundance of pure gold. There's gold and there's pure gold. While we've been being taught. Man, it's blessed me these last months. There's a new anointing on the pastor. There's always been anointing, but there's a new fresh anointing. But there's gold, and then there's the pure gold. David, he knew it back then. He says that they're more precious than gold, than an abundance of pure gold. They're sweeter than honey that's right out of the honeycomb. It's better than all these things. He says, in addition, your servant is warned by them, and there's great reward in keeping them. That's the thing that ministers to me. There's great reward in keeping the principles of God. He gives us these things. It's for our good. It's for our good. That's what I want our perspective to be. These principles, giving him the first, it's for our good. And so that we can reach others and do what we need to there. The last point, God desires to bless his children. Over in Malachi, it says, well, a man robbed God. He says, yet you've robbed me. And they say, how have we robbed you in your tithes and your offerings? Well, God owns it all. So how are we robbing? Does he need our money? He doesn't need our money. He wants our hearts. He wants it out of our head and into our hearts. He desires our hearts. And I really believe in a teaching that where it changed our point of view. We don't rob him of the gold, the silver, our money, our time. What we do, we rob him of the chance to bless us. We really rob him of the chance to give the blessings that he desires for us. He so wants to bless us. And I thought I understood this as I had the best dad in the world. We all need to think that about our dads, that they were the best one. But Dad, he gave me the right examples. And I knew I could go to my dad anytime, anything he had, I could go up there and he would do his best to give me whatever I needed if I asked within reason. And he wanted to bless me. He wanted to give to me. And I thought I understood that. I thought I understood how my dad wanted to do something for me. But I didn't. I did not fully understand it until I was a father. I understood it as a son, but when I was a father, and how I want to bless my son, it's incomparable. I didn't realize how my dad really wanted to bless. I knew it, but then I really knew it when I had a kid of my own. Here a while back, Cody and his wife were building a new house, and they were a little bit short on some money, so they didn't have to pay the PMI. Just things that kind of added up. They're just a little bit short. He came to me, and he asked me for a loan. Because, I mean, they've done very good. They're very frugal. They're very wise. They've done good. God's blessed them. But he said, can we borrow some money? It thrilled me just to giving the money. I don't want to make a loan to my son. I want to bless my son. Matthew, it says, if you who are evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more does the Father in heaven know to bless you? It's talking about it's for our good. These principles are all for our good. I think I understand it when I talk about wanting to bless my son, but I have no idea how much our Heavenly Father really wants to bless us. I'm understanding more and more the older I get. The onions are getting peeled. The onion's getting a little bit smaller, but there's still a lot left. There's a lot more. And we're closing down. I've given you the basis of what I really believe, and I believe what changed Suzanne and mine's life. But I want to just give you a couple of testimonies. I could go forever on this. There's not enough time to even really start, but I want to give you the most recent one. We were fixing to go to Colorado, and there's a ministry we support. The guy, it's over in Dallas, called Dallas Metro. The guy's name is Clay Wallace, and they take a Sunday school to these kids that don't get to go, that's in the projects and stuff, And they don't just leave it there. They visit every kid every week in their house. They do a great work. And this guy gave up everything. And he's been doing this for over 35 years. So we try to support. And we'll either give one or two amounts. And you're usually pretty consistent. God was dealing with me. I need to give them a check. I need to send something in there to them. But the amount that I was feeling in my spirit was a lot different than what we'd been doing. And I'm sitting there going, man, I think this is just me. It might be another Dairy Queen moment where we're giving something. God's not saying that. God, are you really saying this? I'm thinking, is it just me? I go to Suzanne. We're fixing to go to Colorado. I said, hey, before we go, we got to get a check to Clay. And she said, how much? And she said the two amounts. I said, a little bit different. I told her the amount. And she, just the way her eyebrows, when I'm in trouble, when she's not sure, they go up. They go past her hairline. And I'm sitting there going, and I said, I think this is just me. I said, look, okay, let's don't do it. Let's pray about it. 2 weeks go by. She checks my email. I'm horrible. I hate that junk. But if it's something important, she brings me the email. And she said, hey, look at this. She said, you need to look at this email. Clay had just put one out. And they're trying to reach people a different way because all this COVID junk, they're not letting it rule them. They're making ways around. And they're doing it with an ice cream truck. They had the truck donated, but they needed to get everything fixed up on the inside, the freezers, all this kind of stuff. He had an amount down there that they needed. That amount was what God was telling me. There was $150 difference, was all the difference was. And what he was telling me was a little bit more. There's $150 more. And I sat there and I looked at that, and she knew right then. My hard-headedness. I called Clay right then. I said, Clay, go do what you need to do. And I said, I went and sat back down. I was fixing to leave the house. I said, Clay, go do it. The needs met. The check's in the mail today. He goes, how much? I said, God spoke to me to do all of it. He told me a month ago we shouldn't even have to do it. But I'm going to pray through this that there's 10 more ignorant, hard-headed people just like me, and you'll get 10 times what you asked for. I said, I wish I'd have just done it. You'd have never even had to make that plea. But God was speaking to me, too, so I can learn from it. He knows I'm hard-headed. He knows I'm not the sharpest knife in the drawer. It takes a few times for me. That's not the end of the story, though. We do that. And I thought, man, God, you're so good on this. And thank you. And I'm telling you, it is a pure joy to give. Used to, we wouldn't do that, wouldn't think about doing it. And now when God speaks, we try to give. We try to do what it is. And please don't think I'm saying give to get. I'm not saying that at all. And I'm not trying to toot our own horns. I'm just trying to let you know what God has done for us. He wants to do for every one of us in this area. He wants to bless us more than we can imagine. And please, do not think I'm trying to brag on ourselves. I'm the lowest son of a gun in here. Please. I mean, I was raised, I had the best example. I should be so much further. Me and Richard were talking this morning. I should be so much further. I'm a failure. I should be so much further than where I'm at. I'm glad we have a merciful God and a God that does love us. And even through our failures and our ignorance and our disbelief, He still wants to bless. I thank Him for that. The rest of the story. We go to Colorado, we come back. We're gone for a couple of weeks, and I'm working some overtime. God bless us. See, another thing, He blesses you right over. I mean, there's a lot of overtime. I'm getting that where it's out of the blue. Watermelons failed, hogs got in there. I mean, a lot of stuff is gone. Now, all this overtime, everything, God takes care. I cannot create or manufacture these things. He does it. We get back from Colorado, and Suzanne gets back, and it's a small office. She works for a big investment deal, but it's just a guy, the guy that owns it, and there's a guy named Trey, and he's the investor, researches everything, and he's the main one there. But he doesn't write the checks. This other guy does. He's another employee just like Suzanne. Suzanne's the bookkeeper, office manager, that kind of deal. Well, anyway, I was gone for a couple of weeks, and like I said, I was working overtime. She's the last one in the office, and she's going to meet me, and I know I'm stumbling around. But anyway, she's going to meet me afterwards, and she goes to leave, and there's an envelope on her desk. Now, where does that come from? She looks at that envelope, and in it is a note. It said, man, thank you so much for what you're doing. It's from Trey, the fellow employee, not the owner, not the guy that writes the checks. He's just a fellow employee. It says, thank you so much for what you do, and I realize I cannot do what I do without you being here. Please don't move to Colorado. And so he said, this is how I want to express my thanks for you. This is not the boss. There's a check in there. The check is for exactly what we've just given away. Exactly. There's no mistake. God speaks to us to encourage us to do it whenever he speaks to us. That just built my faith so much. I'm still learning this principle of first. I'm still learning. And it just goes on. I just want to be faithful and do it. I'm not going to try to do more. I just want to be faithful in what he gives us. And he's blessed us so much. And a lot of it's when we get it out of our head and into our heart. It's not about 10%. It's not just doing the first. It's when it gets in our heart, it changes our hearts to where we want to do it and we want to bless others. We want to be a river. We don't want to be a reservoir. And we get blessed along the way anyway. God has been so good. I'm winding this up, but I want to talk about my dad for a second. I read something this morning. We had some stuff out about my dad. If you don't know, my dad passed away last week. And so he was going through some things, and we had a deal from his 80th birthday. We had all this up there, and I didn't look at a lot of stuff. Anyway, it's a scrapbook that my niece had put together for his 80th birthday. I read this morning, and I was up studying again, just trying to make sure, because I don't like getting up here and stumbling around in front of y'all. But I was reading this, and I thought, man, 14 years ago I wrote, thank you for living out the godly. Thanks for living out the godly principles in front of me over and over and over. It was lived in front of me. I should be so much further. He lived them out. He's a testimony to God's principles. Just like David said, they're better than gold. They're better than the purest gold. Better than the honey. There's great reward in keeping them. He was consistent, and he led this out. It wasn't in his head. It was in his heart. It's for our good. This is the last thing I want to say. We're closing down. A few weeks ago, Dad, he broke his hip early in the spring. And he had to go to a rehab. Well, his strength went down. He ended up had to have a blood transfusion. He was bleeding internally. That knocked him back. Rehab extended. Then he got COVID. Then he was in the hospital about three times with COVID. And it just went on and on. It just knocked him down. My dad's 94. And so it got to where he wasn't going to be able to go back home, back to where he was living. And so we're seeing there had to be a change. Medicare had been taken, but Dad still had a pension. You know how Medicare works. He still had a pension, so that's going to be, what's going to happen? We had some savings, because the level of his income a month and what it was taking to keep this type of care up, there was a lot of difference. So he's having to take away from what savings he had, and it wasn't a lot. He's having to take it away to make the monthly deal. And my dad, they let us have a face-to-face. I mean, they was trying to keep us out because of COVID. I said, no, we're going over my dad at this. He knows what's going on. I want this to be every bit on him. I got several things I need to present to him. He's an accountant. And so he wanted to know the bottom line. I already had it figured out. And I said, okay, doing this, the savings will run out on this date. And he goes, okay. And he goes, well, maybe. I said, no, Dad. I said, after that, I said, we'll just, me and Carol, my sister, we'll take care of it. Don't worry about it. It'll be taken care of. You don't have to change anything. And then he goes, well, really, what do you think? I said, you don't know what I really think? If I was you, I would not get another battery for my pacemaker is what I would do. He just shakes his head. He goes, I can't even talk to you. But he knew what I was saying. You know, this is one thing. He's having to make choices. But there was one line up there on his monthly income, what he could do. He's paying this. He's getting his pension, his Social Security. He was still paying his tithes and giving offering. 94. Still doing that. The principles, he's still living. He's still living to his very last. I said, okay, Dad, here's one more thing. I knew that was your answer. I said, do you want to cut that out? No. But, I mean, before I could even get out, no, I'm not doing it. I said, I'm still giving that. Even if I got to change, I said, well, you ain't got to change nothing. I said, do that, we'll take. But he said, I'm not changing that. And it was way more than 10% what he was giving. The 10%, when you start making the principle of first, I'm telling you, you fly by the 10%. You look back, you know, when you look at the end of the year, you're like, man, I wish I really did. That was 10% of what I was making. But Dad, it wasn't in his head. It was in his heart. Because he's an accountant, the smart thing to do, the common sense thing, to at least knock it down to 10%. Most people would say, okay, I'm going to knock that out. I'm going to, at the end of life, all that, I'm going to knock the whole thing out. And I'm going to let this extend longer because I don't know how long I'm going to be here. It wasn't even an option. When we have the principles of God only in our head, there's always room for compromise. There's always room for compromise if it's only in your head. But when it gets into your heart, it gets down in that spirit, gets in your spirit. And we believe we have the Spirit of God within us, right? We have the Spirit of with us. When our spirit agrees with the Spirit of God over His principles, it's something so much stronger. There's a synergy there. It's so much stronger than just that by itself. We're not by ourselves. We're with the principles of God. We're binding, we're uniting with His principles, and He blesses it. It takes us further than we could ever take ourselves. He's going to bless the rest. You know what? That was, he came off of that. It ended up being October 1st where he is going to start having to pay his own. And didn't even make it a full month. I wondered why God even let him go this long. We've been praying that God would just go to sleep before he ever got to this rehab point and all this kind of stuff. That God would just take him. I didn't understand why. But I've said this before. God, his prayer every day was, God, let me be a blessing to somebody. And he was. Nurses came in that day that he, last Saturday, when everybody kind of figured out this was pretty close to the end, they were coming in off duty to come see Dad. He blessed somebody every day. That was his life. He was a river. He wasn't a reservoir. He always blessed him. It's always about somebody else, and he did it joyfully. That's the thing about it. He was a cheerful giver. There's great reward in keeping the principles of God. My dad's a testimony. I want to try to live up to just a shadow of it. If I can just be in a shadow of that. I just want to encourage you today, our view of God, let it be that it's for your good. He desires to bless us more than we can ever imagine, more than you ever can think about blessing your kids. He desires to bless us and do the work in us that he wants to do. We're going to close up. Pastor, I don't know where you're at today. I don't know where your relationship is with God. I think this is a pretty solid core right here that we've got. I'm sure we've got relationships with God, but we can always get better. When we get it in our spirit that it's for our good, it keeps us going. I think today would be a good day just to recommit some things in our lives, in our mind first, but then that it gets out of our head and down into our spirit. I pray that's the biggest thing. Let it get down in your spirit. That the principles of God, not just the giving, but all of them. My pastor's been preaching, reaching for the better gold. And pastor, your message is getting into people. Last week, study at brother's house. Frank was there. And he's talking about, I've settled for gold-plated stuff all my life. I want to get the real gold now. It's getting in people's spirit. It's getting in my spirit, our view of God. It's for our good. That is all I really have. There's one more thing I already forgot. I'm closed. This is over with. But God is so good on things. And you wonder, well, am I supposed to be doing this? And is this just me? Whatever. But I always look at the verse of the day on the Bible app. I'm sure everybody does. A lot of people do. I looked at it this morning whenever I was getting ready to go, and I wonder what it says today. It says, a generous person will be enriched, and the one who gives a drink of water will receive water. I'm closing with that.